This was kind of interesting because we just started this in 2019. So the top is the number of hunter days and the bottom is number of hunter hours. And it's comparing 2019 to 2020. And so you can see there was a big increase from 2019 to 2020 in the number of days and the number of hours that people spent turkey hunting, which is probably a result of COVID.
So Allison, do you think we're going to see similar participation this spring?
Absolutely. Yeah. License sales are already up this year compared to where they were last year. So there's a good chance that we're going to have a lot of hunters out there again this spring. So to go into the history of the restoration a little bit, wild turkeys are native in North America and here in New Hampshire. However, when settlers came along and changed the landscape, we went from a forested landscape to an agricultural landscape, back to a forested landscape. And that change in habitat definitely influenced the turkey population. But also during that time, there were no regulated hunting seasons or rules or bag limits or anything like that about turkey hunting. And so our over-harvesting took part in the decline of wild turkeys throughout the country, really. Here in New Hampshire, the last turkey, wild turkey, was reported in the town of Ware in 1854. So from 1854 until 1969, there were no turkeys in the state of New Hampshire. And then the winter of 1969-1970 was when New Hampshire Fish and Game first attempted to reintroduce turkeys into the state, and they traded Fisher for turkeys with the state of West Virginia. Those turkeys were released over at Pawtuckaway State Park. But unfortunately, that first attempt failed. And then a few years later, they tried again, and they got some turkeys from New York, and they got 25 turkeys that were released in Walpole. And those turkeys did really well. And as that population started to grow, they were able to take birds from that population and move them around the state. So each one of these circles on the map is a different location where turkeys were relocated. So from 1975 until 1995, fish and game biologists were trapping and transferring turkeys around the state to help reintroduce them here in New Hampshire.
Originated from New York in New England and stuff. Allegheny State Park in New York was the source for many of New England's turkeys. And it's really amazing to see how from such humble beginnings, New Hampshire's turkey population is just grown tremendously.
Absolutely. And they think that those turkeys from New York were a little bit more hardy and able to survive the winter here in New Hampshire better than the turkeys from West Virginia were.
Yep.
But at the same time, neighboring Vermont and Maine were doing the same thing. So, you know, we may have had some birds cross over to their states and they may have had some birds cross over to our states, but, you know, the whole Northeast was doing this. So it really was a collaborative effort. So yeah, like Matt said, that initial population of 25 birds that was released here has now grown to around 50,000 birds statewide. And just to show over time how that population has grown from the 1980s up until 2020, it has steadily grown. And as that population has grown, it has allowed turkey hunters to have more opportunities to get out there and turkey hunt. 1980 was the first regulated turkey hunting season in the state, and it was done by a lottery. And if I recall, I think it was like 30 people that harvested turkeys that year. And now we're over 5,000 turkeys harvested a year. So one thing that I think is really important for hunters to know is that turkey management is only made possible because of sportsmen and sportsmen's contributions. So whenever you buy something that's related to hunting, there's a federal tax on it, and this goes into a dedicated account, and that is a national account administered by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. And the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service has this formula where they divvy up the money that's raised and distribute it to different states across the country, and that goes directly back to wildlife management. So through that federal Pittman-Robertson or Wildlife Restoration Act, in this year, 2021, New Hampshire is receiving over $4 million from that Pittman-Robertson account. So that's all because of hunters and the things that you buy related to hunting and shooting sports. So turkey management is one of the things that benefits from this. And the federal money will cover up to 75% of wildlife management activities. The states need to come up with 25% matching funds. And one of the ways that we do that is through hunting licenses and turkey tags that are sold. So every turkey tag and every hunting license directly helps benefit wildlife management here in the state. All right, so probably what everybody wants to know about, the turkey stuff, right? Not the money. All right, so how do you tell a male from a female? This is a very important thing to know if you're gonna be heading out turkey hunting this spring. So in New Hampshire, you can shoot a bearded bird in the spring. And typically the males have beards, but females can also have a beard, but there's many other characteristics to look for as well. So we'll start with the female up top here. The head is a gray bluish color. There's a very, I don't know if my pointer is working on here or not. Anybody can see that?
Yep. Yeah, I see it.
Oh, there it is. Okay. Yep. So the dewlap right here is pretty minimal. The snood, pretty minimal and not really any caruncles versus the tom or the male. Those features are much more pronounced and much more visible. Also, if you don't actually see the birds, but if you're out there scouting and you come across some turkey scat, you can tell the difference whether it's a male or a female, because the female leaves a little dropping that some, compared to like a soft serve ice cream, it's just a little flop there. And then the male just leaves like a J-shaped dropping on the ground. So you can tell the difference by looking at the scat as well. Depending where you are in the state, I don't know, down in the southern part here, we pretty much, snow's pretty much all gone.
It's mud, it's mud tracks now.
Mud, exactly. But up north, I'm sure there's still some snow, and I think I heard there's snow in the forecast for tomorrow. But again, if you're out doing some scouting, you might come across some turkey tracks in the snow. Pretty cool to see kind of prehistoric looking pterodactyl things here. All right, so the male, again, those more prominent features on the head, and also, as you can see in the picture here, the vibrant red and blue colors of the head and the white skull cap are very prominent as well. And the beard you can see here on the male. So male turkeys, when they're young, less than a year old, they're called jakes, and they weigh between 12 to 15 pounds. And after a year old, they're referred to as toms or gobblers and can weigh 16 to 25 pounds. The males, you'll see in the spring, even now already, people are seeing this happen with the males starting to display and gobble and strut. And then just another image to show those features that you're looking for on the male bird with the very vibrant red, white, and blue colors on the head. The snood that becomes elongated and the caruncles and around the head area that is going to be your target when you're out there hunting. Let's see. One other thing, the feathers. So you can tell the difference between the male and the female by looking at the chest feathers. And on the male, they are black tipped versus the female, which is a little different. So some for comparison, some pictures of the female here. A juvenile is called a jenny, and adults are referred to as hens. They are between 8 to 13 pounds typically. The head colors are much more dull, grayish, bluish color, and those features are much less prominent. They rarely have spurs and rarely have beards, but they can have beards. About 6 to 10% of hens are estimated to have beards. And then those chest feathers are brown tipped instead of black tipped on the male.
So Allison, it's all really good, characteristics and stuff. What do you find is the best way to sort a male out from a female in the field under hunting conditions? Are you Are you looking for a beard? Are you looking for, you know, just the general wash of coloration, that dark iridescence versus the washed out brown? Are you looking at size? What's a good field indicator for people to use when they're out in the field and you know that the bird's coming and you're all excited about what's going on here?
Definitely. When you're out there and the adrenaline starts running and you're getting all excited, it's all of those things and looking for all of those characteristics. So I think, first of all, the thing you're going to notice, though, is the gobbling, hearing the gobbling off in the distance. And that's one of the most exciting parts of turkey hunting, I think, is that when you're calling them in, and it can take a long time sometimes to work those birds and get them to come in within shooting range. But hearing them gobbling and hearing them come in, but being patient to make sure that you get a visual on the bird and knowing what you're shooting at before you take that shot, because there could very well be hens that are coming into those calls as well, and they may be coming in silent, or you may have another tom that's coming in silent while you have another one that's very vocal off in the distance. So it's really taking in all of your surroundings and remembering all those different characteristics and trying to identify what your target is before you take that shot. And then if you do see the hens and the toms side by side, a comparison to show the difference in the size and coloration between the males and the females. All right, so how do you age your gobbler once you've harvested one? So one of the easiest ways to tell the difference between an adult versus a juvenile is to look at the tail, the fan. And on an adult over here, you're going to have this nice regular contour of all of the feathers evenly distributed around the fan. Versus on a juvenile, because they haven't completely molted and grown all their new feathers yet, they're going to have an irregular shape to their fan, and those middle feathers are going to stick up a little bit higher than the outer edges. I keep losing my mouse here. Another way is to look at the wings and the wing feathers on the what's called the 9th and the 10th primaries on the wings here. So on a juvenile, those are going to be more pointed and dark tipped with no barring. And then on the adults, as they get older, they have white barring that goes all the way to the end, but they also become more rounded because they're dragging on the ground more. And just a closer up picture to show you what that looks like on the adults with the barring going all the way to the tips versus the juveniles that are dark on the tips there and more pointed on the juveniles. And then a couple other things that hunters are always interested in looking at are the spurs and the beards. And in general, with age, the spurs will get longer and the beards will get longer. So a one-year-old bird will have a half inch or less in spurs. And then as they get older in age, those spurs get much bigger and sharper and pointier. And same with the beards, they continue to grow. And so the older the older the bird, the longer the beard. So a little bit about behavior and what they're doing this time of year. So we're coming out of winter right now. During the winter, the males and the females group together in what's called mixed flocks, and they'll stick together pretty much wherever there's food available during the winter. So you may see large groups had reports of 20, 40, 50 or more birds this winter. So there's some good sized flocks out there. Over the winter, snow condition and depth is one of the critical things to their survival through the winter. And if it's a real crusty snow, they can walk on top of it. But if it's that real fluffy, deep snow, then they have a hard time walking around and have to use more energy to try to get around and find food. But they can actually sustain themselves for up to 10 days or so if they can't travel around. One of the things that may have helped them become established and so abundant in the state is the availability of human-related foods, and in particular backyard bird feeders. So we do a winter flock survey online every year, And the highest amount of observations come from people who see turkeys feeding on sunflower seeds at their bird feeders. But we're moving into spring now. What, tomorrow's April 1st, right? So we're moving into spring and the flocks are starting to break up. I think as we said earlier, people are starting to see some of those toms already displaying and strutting around. So as we move into spring, those mixed flocks are breaking up and the hens go off on their own and the males go off on their own and they're getting ready for breeding season to start taking place here. Days are getting longer, days are getting warmer, and that photo period is part of what helps to instigate this behavioral change as we move into their breeding season. So the toms will strut and display to try to attract a female, and the female has her choice of which male she wants to breed with. The males can become aggressive. I tried to shorten this, so I took some of the pictures out, but the males can become aggressive and towards each other while competing for a female's attention and the opportunity to breed with a female. And then after breeding occurs, we have nesting that's going to take place here in the next month or so. Nest size typically are around 12 eggs is an average clutch size, and the hens will incubate for 25 to 30 days. So when the hen starts establishing her nest, she lays one egg a day, roughly. So it can take over a week for her to establish that nest site. And in the meantime, she'll lay an egg and she'll go off and feed and she'll come back and lay an egg. But once all the eggs are laid, she will sit on the nest and start incubating. And then at that point, she'll incubate, you know, for up to a month. And then that way, all of the eggs are being incubated for the same amount of time and they'll all hatch within the roughly the same amount of time. So there is a lot of predation that happens on nests during the spring. Everything seems to like to eat turkeys and turkey eggs. So either the hen can be predated while she's sitting on the nest or the eggs can be predated. If the eggs are predated, then the hen may re-nest and lay a second clutch. So one of the things that we track is hatching and when the peak hatching occurs. And ideally what you'd like to see is like an earlier hatch so that the young have time to grow and get strong before winter comes and have a better chance of survival through the winter. So we can see here our peak hatching. We have a few different years represented here, but our peak hatching occurs in June, early to mid-June. But it's pretty much a bell curve, and this is very dependent on weather. And if we have, you know, a real rainy start and they lose a clutch at first, then they may re-nest, which means that the second nest isn't going to hatch until later. But really, we, you know, would like to see them hatching out earlier so that they have time to grow and a better chance of surviving through the winter. If they're not hatching until August, they really don't have that much time to grow and be big enough and strong enough to survive going into the winter months. So when the young are born, the young turkeys are called poults, and they're referred to as what's called precocial because they have their feathers already and their eyes are open and they're able to get up and walk around and follow mom around and feed themselves soon after hatching. Versus other birds like robins, when they hatch, they stay in the nest, they don't have any feathers, their eyes are closed, and they're completely dependent on their mother to bring them food. Turkeys are up and about and pretty independent soon after hatching.
Allison, what do you think the biggest nest predator is for turkeys in the Northeast?
Raccoons. That would be my guess. There's a lot of predators that like to feed on the turkeys and the eggs. But the decline in trapping participation, recreational trapping over the years, nobody traps raccoons anymore. And there's a lot of raccoons out there and they will, they'll take the eggs pretty easily. They'll scare the hen right off the nest and eat the eggs. But yeah, everything likes to eat turkeys, including us. Yep.
That's right. Everything likes to eat turkeys, from snakes to owls, right? So
yeah. And gosh, yeah, we have a bobcat population that's reestablished in the state now too. So yep. Fisher, everything. But yeah, so once the young hatch and they're up and mobile and following mom around, so you might see this, you know, come early June. Well, they're out there feeding with mom. So they're omnivores and they'll feed on pretty much anything that's available. But the young really need insects when they're first born, because it's high in protein, and that protein helps them to grow and get strong quicker. Within about a week or so after hatching, they're able to fly up into the trees and roost with mom at night. And just another picture here of some turkeys roosting at night. So when you're out doing your scouting this spring, a lot of people like to go out in the evening and use some locator calls, which there's gonna be a whole nother session on calling, so we won't go into that too much. But going out in the evening hours and using some locator calls and finding out where the birds are roosting is a really great approach to pick your spots where you're going to hunt the following morning or when the season opens. So let's see, habitat and diet. Their average home range is 4 to 5 square miles, but they can travel a lot further than that. There's been studies done where they radio collar turkeys or put radio transmitters on them and track them with radio telemetry, and have found that they can travel up to 30 miles in a day. So they can travel pretty far. Again, they're omnivorous opportunists, trying to say that. And they'll eat whatever's available depending on the season. And again, animal matter, insects, that high protein is very important for the young. And for the adults, makes up approximately 10% of their diet. And the rest is seeds and berries and nuts and those sorts of things. Josh, how are we doing for time? We good? Okay. So I can't wait to see this in the spring when everything's green like this again. But the dandelions, the whole point of this picture is the dandelions. And as soon as you see those dandelions come up, you're probably going to see turkeys out there in those fields, because dandelions are one of their favorite foods in the spring. Corn, and especially in a type of setting like this where you have some tall mature trees for roosting along the edges of an opening, so they have a place to sleep at night and then they can fly down in the morning and get some food pretty easily. It's a nice setup. And power lines. Again, you've got the tall mature trees along the edges of the power line for roosting at night, with the open power line strip there and lots of different types of berries that are growing on the power lines. Everything from blueberries, raspberries, blackberries, and juniper. And then all the seeds as well from the various plants on the power line. Lots of food sources out on the power lines for them. And then also the hard mast. So acorns and beech nuts are a big part of their diet. And right now, the snow is melting and there's still a lot of acorns out there on the ground. So they're doing a lot of scraping and scratching through leaf litter and digging up those acorns to feed on. And now, and as well as like through the winter and in the fall months as well. So hard mast is another important part of their diet. And then in winter time, like I mentioned earlier, those backyard bird feeders. So if we have really deep snow and they can't scratch and get to the ground and get to those acorns that are on the ground, and there's no soft mast available for them, backyard bird feeders have been known to grow some very big turkeys. And then I think this was the last part I just wanted to touch on real quick. Avian pox and LPDV, or the lymphoproliferative disease virus. These are two viruses that we know are present in the wild turkey population. Avian pox has been around for a very long time. LPDV was first reported in the US in 2009. Fish and game has been monitoring both of these diseases here in New Hampshire since 2011. And we know that they're present in the turkeys, but they don't seem to be negatively impacting the population overall. So if you harvest a turkey that has symptoms, it can result in these crusty lesions or warts on the non-feathered parts of the birds, and just rather unsightly to look at. So the picture down here on the bottom, you can see the lesions forming around the eye. Sometimes if those lesions or warts get too big, they can impair their vision and make it hard for them to get around and find food, which can lead to starvation. But sometimes they can be infected with these viruses and have no symptoms at all, or sometimes they can develop symptoms and then they clear up on their own. But overall, they don't seem to be negatively impacting the population. And then I think this was the last slide, just a couple more pictures of this. So it can also affect the legs, because again, it affects the non-feathered portions of the bird. And they can have these lesions either externally or internally in the digestive tract or in the respiratory tract. And if they develop them internally, it can cause problems for them feeding or breathing, and that can result in death depending on the bird and how severe the infection is. There are no known human health risks associated with these viruses. So if a hunter is to harvest a bird that has symptoms, everything that we know about these viruses, as long as they're cooked properly, they are safe to consume.
So Allison, now that you've given everybody nightmares looking at that picture on the bottom left, if somebody harvests a bird with these symptoms, should they reach out to you? Or are you tracking that stuff? Or now that you know that it's present in the population, there's no real need to report. What's your preference?
No real need to report. We have two online surveys. We have the winter flock survey that runs through the winter months, and then we have the summer brood survey that runs June, July, and August. And both of those surveys request information on sightings, and if you're seeing birds with symptoms, you can report it through those online surveys. So that's really how we're collecting distribution data on the prevalence of these now. However, if a hunter shoots a bird and it just looks terrible, they can give us a call and let us know about it, and we'll handle that on a case-by-case situation.
Great.
And I think that was the last slide. Yep.
Well, that was awesome. Josh, you got any questions for us? Anybody in the presentation, if you guys have questions, please put them in the chat.
You've answered the one about being able to eat the meat, but we do have one other. They're asking if you can tell if it's a male or female based on the tracks. Mm-mm. Or the size of the tracks.
No, nothing that I would put money on. No. I think if finding the droppings, like Allison said, I think would be a good field indicator. Unless you know different, Allison, I don't know of any.
No, I was just going to say the tracks will lead you in the right direction, though, so you can go find the bird and figure it out.
That's right. So I guess, I had a question, Allison. I know that any time of year, theoretically, you can hear a bird gobble. But mm-hmm. I know that I'm often hearing birds gobbling in March and in April. I routinely get asked the question, why do we wait till May 1st to start our turkey season?
Absolutely.
And I wondered if you could, turkey biologist, put your turkey biologist hat on and kind of give the rationale behind how you guys set the season in New Hampshire.
Yeah, I know a lot of people, myself included, we get really excited when we start to see them strutting and hear them gobbling. I just had them outside my house last week gobbling, and you get so excited and you get all worked up and you can't wait for turkey season to start. But the whole point of turkey management is maintaining a healthy, stable population and maintaining it at a level where hopefully there is a surplus so that we can have those hunting opportunities. So the hunting season is timed the way that it is to give the birds an opportunity to start breeding and for some of the hens to be nesting already and have a chance to start reproducing, getting that next generation going before we are out there as hunters in the woods and going after them and interrupting what they naturally are doing this time of year. We're hearing them, starting to hear them gobble and starting to see them strut already, which is really exciting. But we need to remember too, there's a whole bell curve to this. And it's starting now, but we still have a long ways to go. They're not gonna be done by May 1st. There's gonna be plenty of time to still get out there and hear lots of gobbles and see lots of birds strutting. So we wanna give them an opportunity to start breeding. And then, when a lot of the hens are hopefully on the nest already, there's gonna be a lot of toms out there that are still ready to go.
Still looking for love, perfect timing
for the hunters to get out there and call in those lonely toms.
Yeah, awesome.
Hey, Allison, I think we have time for one more question.
And then okay.
We'll move on to Jonathan. So Tyler asks, is there a biological function of the snood and the caruncles? Besides attracting, being an attractant.
Yeah, it's really just display and trying to attract the females. The snood becomes elongated when the male gets excited and like his head turns all those vibrant colors, the snood will become elongated. And one theory is that the longer the snood, the better the male is for breeding. I don't know.
Okay, we got one more. It's not a question. They're asking to see the slide of the adult versus juvenile. I think the fan is what they're. I think they're looking for the fan.
Okay, there it is. Oh. So either one would look very nice mounted on your wall.
Absolutely. And that can be a good field indicator. When you're out hunting, if you can take the time to look at your birds and stuff, that definitely stands out.
Mm.
Yep. All right.
Yep.
Jonathan, tell us what we need to know to not get a visit from you in the woods this spring. All right.
I cover a lot of territory, but hopefully I'm not traveling all around the state come this spring, but... The basic concepts of what you need to know is going to be in your hunting digests. These are where you purchase your license. They're at every fish and game regional office, headquarters in Concord. And this is going to be your guidebook. This is going to come out every fall. This one here is the current one you'll need for this spring season. So it's going to be through August. Come September, there'll be a new one out. In this digest is what you'll need to know. Specifically for the turkey, we have a whole page on page 26 dedicated all the turkey and turkey hunting. So knowing what's in this digest is what's gonna get you through as far as the laws and rules portion that you'll need to know. Turkey hunting, to start, you're gonna need a license. Turkey hunting is unique in that all ages require a license. So even if you're bringing someone out that is 12 years old, they need to purchase just the turkey license. So if you're 16 or older, you're going to have your hunting license and your turkey license. Under 16, you're going to have just your turkey license. So that's a little unique where if you're a minor or a youth, we still do require you to get that turkey license. That license will give you two tags. And you'll have your spring season and your fall season, just like Allison described. A big thing with where you're hunting and where you're going out is to know your wildlife management unit. Know where you're going to be, where you're hunting. In the digest, we do have a page, or actually two pages, that are dedicated to knowing what wildlife management unit you're in. Wildlife management units, the state's just broken down in all these units. And it's important to know what wildlife management unit you're in because they can have different seasons, bag limits, regulations, rule, everything can be different. So researching what wildlife management unit you'll be in is key. So come this spring, we'll have our spring season, May, month of May. You'll have The hunting hours for that half hour before sunrise, and it ends at noon. A little different than if you're a deer hunter where it's going from a half hour before to a half hour after. That spring season stops at noon. In the digest, we have another chart that tells you your sunrise and sunset table here. You'll have everything you need to know right in this digest. It'll tell you that time. So ending at the noon time in the spring is a big thing. The shotguns are, 10 gauge through 20 gauge. There's a lot of new proposed legislation, rules, laws that are going into, trying to get passed. Stick to what's in this. If when the new one comes out, it's going to have the new information in it. This is what you'll want to go by. The digest that we provide you with, it's free and it has all the information you'll need to know. Just making sure I cover everything. Some folks, you're becoming more aware of these electronic decoys that move and whatnot. They're not illegal to use. Electronic calls are illegal, but those are not illegal right at the moment. But a lot of these laws and rules come down to just the responsibility of the hunter. Having your responsibility, your ethical background, knowing, is it a good decision? Is it not? Is it safe? Is it not? A lot of people going to be in the woods. It's busy. We're selling licenses. We have a lot of licenses people are purchasing. The woods, as vast as they are, may be crowded in a lot of areas. There's only so many fields and so many pieces of woods that people can hunt. Take the time to scout your area. Know your area, scout it, know the houses that are around, meet the landowners, introduce yourself, know the surroundings, know the birds. Just put in the time ahead of time. We're seeing a lot of folks just last minute hopping in the truck and just driving around. And the whole sport is just getting out of the vehicle. You have your license, you have your gear, you did your time ahead of time, putting in the effort to research everything and scout and see what's out there. And then getting out there on opening day or whatever day you could get out to hunt is all part of the process. So other than that, having this digest, having your license, signing your license, you're going to be issued the tags. When you get your bird, tag it immediately. People always think I'm funny when I mention it, but have something to write with. I can't tell you how many hunter eds I've done and said, make sure you bring a pen or pencil, and people go out there, get their bird, and then when that comes down to filling out their tag,
right,
they have nothing to write with. So having a pack with essential gear, map, compass, pen, pencil, the basics, water, food, having that pack and all that gear is crucial when you're heading out scouting, knowing the area. When you get your bird, you're tagging it immediately, and then you're going to register that bird, whether you choose to register it, online, or you plan on registering it at a registration station. Either way, it's got to get registered within 24 hours of you taking it. And then after that, it's on to the next bird, or on to, bringing someone else out, or whatever your plans are. But we want to make sure we try and manage the amount of people that are going to be out there. You're going to have other people. If you're seeing other trucks parked at your field, go someplace else. A lot of folks are seeing another truck there, and then they pull right behind that truck. You have no idea where that hunter is. Plenty of woods. Hopefully you've scouted more than just one spot. Don't put all your eggs in one basket. Scout multiple spots, know the areas. If a truck's there, then a truck's there. Find another spot. No point in going into the woods if someone's already there. So scout multiple spots, know the area, know the landowners, meet the landowners, be courteous. We as hunters, we're all on the same team here. So we need to make sure that we are acting responsibly and ethically in the field, because the actions of one of us kind of reflect on all of us. And when, you know, a person makes a bad move or a bad decision, it kind of reflects on all of us and makes us all look bad. So.
Hey, Jonathan, we got a couple of questions. Can you clarify the whole being able to take two birds in the spring? You know, is there a certain order? You know, we've got these zones that have expanded limits, but do you have to take a bird in another zone first and then one of those zones? Do you have to tag the first bird first and then get your second bird? Seems some confusion on the kind of the order of things and where you can shoot the first one, where you can shoot the second one.
Right. So in the spring season, you're allowed to get two birds. Like Allison talked about, got to be a male or bearded bird. So you just got to be looking for the beard. Statewide, you could get one turkey. You get your turkey, you're going to tag it, and then you're going to register it. Once that bird is legally registered, then you can go out and attempt to get your second bird. However, that second bird has to be in one of the wildlife management units that's listed to take a second bird. So it's got to be in one of D2G, H1, H2, one of those specified units. It won't be allowed statewide. So I don't know if that answers. We definitely want people to shoot their one bird, tag it, register it, and then go out and attempt to get their second, but make sure that you're in the wildlife management units that are allowing that second bird to be taken. That in the digest on page 26, it says, the other spring turkey shall only be taken in wildlife management units H1, H2, J2, K, L, or M. So, and those are generally the wildlife management units where we have, quite a bit of turkey population to sustain taking that second bird. So,
okay. So, Josh, I'm thinking in the, roughly 10 minutes or so that we have left, can you cover, some of the most important rules for safe turkey hunting and what folks should do this spring? I think Jonathan touched on a key one, which is like just have a plan B in your back pocket, and so that you're not, you're not hunting the same area where you don't know where that other hunter is. But what are some of the other basic turkey hunting safety guidelines we should be aware of?
I think the number one is knowing your target and what's beyond. We've seen a few incidents where people are shooting at what they think is a turkey, and it ends up being more often than not a hunting partner or somebody they're with. So identifying that bird head to toe, and then you got to look for the beard. So first determining that it is a turkey that you're seeing, and then you got to look even closer to identify that it has a beard for it to be legal. I think somebody mentioned this earlier about the calling, and it's exciting and you're going to be hearing turkeys and your heart's going to be going thinking that they're coming in, but you should always assume that that calling is another person until you identify that it is a turkey. There are going to be other people in the woods with you and you may not know exactly where they are, and just based on sound alone you can't determine that it is a turkey or not. The other one would be, and I highly recommend, anytime you're moving, to be wearing some sort of orange, whether it be a hat, a vest, something on your pack. If you're moving from one spot to another, having some sort of orange on so any other turkey hunters that are out there can identify you. You can take that off when you're sitting down and you're not moving anymore. But when you're moving from spot to spot or coming out of the woods at the end of the day, and say you harvested a bird, I wouldn't recommend throwing it over your shoulder without some sort of orange, on. So that's it. Identifying your target. If you do that 100% of the time, there shouldn't be any sort of issues there. But I do want to, just in the last minute or two, give a quick update on hunter education. I don't know how many people that have joined us still need to take the class prior to the season. But as of an hour ago, there's pretty minimal space. We're still under some restrictions because of COVID. So we only have, the only way to take hunter education in New Hampshire right now is the online class with a shortened version of our field day. We're hoping after July 1, we'll be able to open all of our classes back up to in-person teaching. But as of right now, if you're still looking for hunter ed or you know somebody that is, we have 16 spots that you could get into prior to turkey season, and another 67 or so through May 5th. And that's really it until, you know, summertime and fall. So as far as hunter education options, those are that's all we have. If you haven't taken hunter ed and you still want to get out turkey hunting, we do have the apprentice hunting license option, which allows you to hunt with a licensed adult 18 plus. So you could get the apprentice license for this turkey season, get your turkey tags, and then take hunter ed sometime this late spring, summer, and get your personal hunting license for the fall.
Sounds like there's a supply demand issue right now with COVID, right? And stuff. So hope all you guys getting ready for turkey hunting checked all your boxes here and stuff. But you know, I think Allison had a good point too. Don't wear red, white, or blue when you're out hunting and stuff. You know, avoid wearing any of those colors that could ever be confused with you know, some of the colors on a gobbler. It's a simple thing. Most of us are going to be in full camo, you know, head to toe, face mask, and all that stuff. So, you know, hopefully you guys are going to stick around for some of our follow-up programming. Tomorrow at 7 p.m., we're going to be having a discussion with some NWTF volunteers in New Hampshire, and they're going to be covering how to get ready for the hunt. And this is going to touch on everything from how to be most effective with your scouting, how to, you know, pattern your shotgun to make sure you know the limits of your gear. And then you'll get some tips and recommendations for what our experienced turkey hunters carry with them in the field. So it should be a really good roundtable discussion. Very much hope that you guys are able to tune into that. We'd be happy to take your questions. And some of our follow-up content next Tuesday, we're going to be having a session devoted exclusively to turkey calling. And that'll be covering everything from friction calls to mouth calls. And then we're going to wrap up next Thursday with a roundtable discussion on turkey hunting tips and tactics, from how to roost a bird the night before to, you know, how to position yourself in the morning successfully to intercept a bird, or what happens when the plan that you had lined up falls apart and all of a sudden it's 8 o'clock in the morning. What do you do now? And so a lot of this comes down to how many different, you know, plans and how fast you can adapt to conditions on the ground. So, you know, it's a lot of great programming. It's going to cover and touch on a lot of the different aspects of turkey hunting. But everybody gets the most out of it when you folks take the time to interact with us and ask your questions and stuff, because we're, you know, hopefully addressing a wide ranging audience with a wide range of experience. And we especially want to make sure that you folks that are on the newer end of the turkey hunting spectrum get your questions answered. So really want to thank Allison and Jonathan and Josh for taking the time to do this with me tonight. I hope you all learned a lot. And I see a question here from Matt. Where can we find recordings? Josh, my understanding is you guys are going to try and record all these sessions and put them on the Fish and Game YouTube channel. Is that correct?
Yep. Once we're complete, they'll be on the YouTube page.
Okay.
Yep. This one was a little cut short. I hit record about 30 seconds late, but we'll get them up there.
No worries. That's awesome. Appreciate everybody that tuned in tonight. And Josh, you got anything else to wrap up with, or are we ready to say goodnight?
No, I think that's it. Thank you for coming.
All right. Thank you, guys. You have a great night.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks.